We're in a series, and I spoke last week that we would be, for the month of February, what is known in our nation as Black History Month. We're going to deal with what I feel are issues that affect those of African descent. Amen. Our theme scripture is righteousness. It's Proverbs 14:34. That'll be the foundation scripture for my next couple messages. But it reads, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Righteousness exalteth a race. The correct interpretation of the word that was interpreted nation was really the word ethos or ethnos, which connotes ethnicity. So you can read it that righteousness exalts an ethnicity, a tribe, a people. Heathens, Gentiles. So righteousness exalteth a people, a tribe, an ethnicity. And our people are struggling in this day and age because sin is our reproach. That's the problem in the Black community. Sin is our reproach. 73% of children born to African American parents are born to single mothers. 73%. The husband has become the baby daddy, the baby father, and there has been no effort to rectify it. And our children are making children at younger and younger ages. Then it perpetuates, it becomes self-perpetuating. Then the church refuses to call sin, sin. The church allows anything to go on. They see boys, feminine, acting like girls, talking with lisps, and sashaying like a girl, but nobody says anything because he is talented and can sing or play an instrument. And we know because if we can allow our musical department to be excellent, we can overlook the fact that he's a little feminine. We won't call sin sin because the Bible clearly says effeminate is a work of the flesh. But we won't call it that. Last week I focused the message toward the Black church institution that one of the issues is we don't demand righteousness in our churches. We'll stay in a church knowing that the pastor or the pastor's wife is involved in an adulterous affair, but we will sit there. We won't stand up. We'll misinterpret scripture and try to look at it in such a way that somehow it's okay. Well, God placed me here to pray for the situation. God would not put you under a sinful leader. Everything in this earth realm is built around a law of gravity. Gravity is one of the foundational laws that I don't understand it, but we are stuck to this planet. And what goes up must come down. So if you understand the law of gravity and you allow yourself to stay under unrighteous leadership, that spirit, see, well, first of all, we got to get to the point where we understand that the natural realm is the lesser realm. The natural realm, has a limitation on it. There is a limitation in the natural of 120 years. There will not be a human that will live longer than 120 years. There's a limitation. There is a limit on the natural world. The eternal world or the supernatural or spiritual world is limited and is not bound by any type of time. God exists in a state of eternal now. And we understand that, you know, we must learn to understand that what takes place in the spirit realm has a greater effect on us than what takes place in the natural realm. But because we're not spirit-led, we are not able to identify the issues of the spirit, so we sit in a situation that we should run from. But this week, I'm not going to focus on institutional unrighteousness. This week, I want to focus on individual unrighteousness. There was a time when you knew what a saved person looked like. There was a time when saved folk would not be anywhere where alcohol of any kind was being openly served. The whole, and I'm not agreeing with it, but if you understood prohibition back in the late last century when alcohol was prohibited nationwide, which was a mistake because it opened the door to many other types of maladies, but the prohibition was birthed as a church movement. It was the church that influenced the government to outlaw alcohol. Now, the problem is, like we dealt with last week, is the unsaved is going to do what the unsaved do, and we can't legislate righteousness. That's the problem. We are trying to influence legislation of righteousness instead of practicing demonstration of righteousness. So we're trying to, don't get an abortion. I'm anti-abortion. But I do understand that a person that does not know Jesus Christ and the pardon of their sin that have been filled with the Holy Ghost, first of all, is going to commit fornication. A person, unregenerate, unsaved, that has not been filled with the Holy Ghost, is going to commit fornication. The problem is, those that claim to be saved is fornicating just as much as them that don't know the Lord. So we have a difficult time demonstrating to the unsaved that abortion is illegal because in the clinic, Sister So-and-so was there too. And she was pregnant with Reverend So-and-so's child. We are so far from where we need to be. We want to legislate marriage. Now, my issue is this. Homosexuals, the gay, lesbian, transsexual, the LGBT or whatever they are, they don't want this. They don't want the Bible. They don't want the Word of God. My question is, why is marriage so important to you if you don't want everything else in the book? Because we gave willingly, hey, we're not going to stop y'all from being together, and we aren't going to prevent you from having all of the rights, but we want to call it civil union. Mm-hmm. Oh, we don't want civil union. We want marriage. We want what God ordained in his word. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother and cleave to his wife. Mm-hmm. But they want that. The way they don't want it the way it's written, but they want all the benefits of the Bible, but they don't want the Bible. My argument is, you don't want that it says that when a man lay with a man as a woman, or a woman lay with a woman as a man, it's an abomination. They don't want to hear that. So they don't want to hear Leviticus chapter 17. They don't want that. No. We just want Genesis chapter 2. Let us get married under your God. Unrighteousness. Church, we're in a dark, dark time. And the problem is our lights have condemned. We aren't demonstrating righteousness because we are too easily to go along with whatever the current trend is. And the world is waxing worse and worse. And the time is coming for the believer to get back to being really, really saved. My text is going to come out of Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And I'm going to read a few verses from the Amplified Bible. Because the time has come where we learn how to undress and get dressed. We need to undress and get dressed. In your Bible, it says that in verse chapter 4, verse 19. Verse 22. That you put off, or you take off, you undress, you take off what you were clothed in your past. That you put off concerning the former conduct or former lifestyle. The old man, which is corrupt according to deceitful lust. You have to take off the old man. Many believers are trying to live, quote, saved, but they are still wearing all of the apparel of the old man. They still have the image of what they used to be. They didn't release their swag. They didn't let go of their, whatever they considered their coolness, their smoothness, their ability to manipulate. I'm talking about, I'm going into the female now, the ability to manipulate and control. They're still wearing that old garment. They haven't taken it off. And they wonder why the world doesn't see a difference. The Bible clearly says that we are to come out from among them and be ye separate. Doesn't mean we are to move to find a jungle somewhere and carve out an encampment and that becomes our, you know, that's slap crazy. What it's saying is that there ought to be a way to identify you even in the midst of them that you aren't like them. There's a benefit to righteousness. We talked last week that righteousness is in the Bible 1116 times. It is important to God that we become a righteous people in our lifestyle, in the way we live, in the way we do business. But I want to start, let's go back. I want us to look at, start with verse 14. And I'm going to read some of verse 14 in the Amplified. It says, so then we may no longer be children. Those that were here last year, we did an awesome message that's on YouTube called Where the Grown Folks At. That we no longer be children tossed like ships to and fro between chance gusts of teaching and wavering with every changing wind of doctrine. There ought to be a steadfastness to what we receive in teaching. This church is going to teach righteousness and holiness. Amen. Period, the end. We are going to teach salvation the way Christ intended, with no compromise, with no foolishness, folly. Because the prey of cunning, that's right, and cleverness of unscrupulous men. That's the problem in the church, that they have, that we have not received, accepted the truth. We have allowed the cunning, sleeky, slick teaching that sounds good. It has a good sound to it. You know, and I'm not just talking about the prosperity message. There's a lot of messages that, you know, there is the God is love and love is love, and as long as we love, it could be any kind of love because love is love. Oh, yeah, because there are churches that don't ever preach righteousness. And they are packed because they preach love. Faith and love, faith and love, faith and love. We teach faith, we teach love, but we teach righteousness. The cleverness of unscrupulous men. Gamblers, this is talking about gamblers engaged in every shifting form of trickery in inventing errors to mislead. Your Bible might, if you read the King James, it says that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men, and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. There is a sound in the church that has been developed by shifting forms of trickery and are inventing errors to mislead. I didn't write this word. I'm just sharing you what said the Lord. But God then says to us, but speaking the truth in love. This is a love message this morning. Righteousness in the Bible 1116 times, because God loves us enough to say that if you will learn to be righteous, learn to actually be saved, there are so many benefits. I was looking this morning, I happened to glance at Psalm, I believe it's Psalm 34, and it says, the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. Oh, what a benefit. The ears of the Lord. In other words, if you have put on righteousness, if you have desired to live righteous, if you have put off concerning the former way of life, conduct, and lifestyle, then God's ears are open to you and he hears your cry. It goes on to say, the righteous cry, verse 17, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. It doesn't say the sinner cries. In fact, the Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard, ruthless, unyielding. It's fun for a season, but the end thereof is death. Then it says in verse 19, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers him out of them all. Their benefits. I say therefore, verse 17, and testify in the Lord that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their mind. That we begin to walk according to our faith, who being past feeling have given themselves over unto lasciviousness to work all uncleanness and greediness. But you have not so learned Christ. If so be that you have heard him and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus. The truth is in Jesus. That you take off, put off, undress the former conduct lifestyle which is corrupt according to deceitful lust. I love the way it reads in the Amplified. It says, strip yourselves of your former nature. Put off and discard your old, unrenewed self, which characterized your previous manner of life and becomes corrupt through lusts and desires that spring from delusion. You have been controlled by lusts and desires that spring from delusion. I'm going to give you an example that I experienced. I struggled in my past. Most of you know my testimony. I struggled with substances. But the one thing that I remember now, and it helped me stay delivered now for 10 years, is it was always a delusion. And those that have been struggled, they say it's chasing a ghost. You never achieve what you really wanted to achieve. And it's not just in substances. It's in, you know, sometimes we'll pursue a unrighteous, unholy relationship. Not always sexual, but it is sexual as well. That we'll pursue a relationship with a person looking for some type of fulfillment, and we never achieve it because it's not there. We have deluded ourselves. We have deceived ourselves into thinking that there's some type of pleasure outside of God's best mandated marriage. And it's just, and when we seek it, we seek it in delusion. It's not there. It can never be there. Sometimes we seek relationships, and I'm talking about sometimes it's male on male. You know, we want to hang out with the boys. We want to hang out with the girls. People have gone in debt trying to keep up with the Joneses, running up credit cards, taking trips that they can't afford, trying to keep up with the coworkers. Just because the coworkers go on a cruise, if you can't afford a cruise, stay home. Put some money in the bank, save, get your bills paid. Amen. You know, so it's not just, you know, sometimes, you know, but you deluded, you have deceived yourself into thinking that you're going to derive some great pleasure from being able to participate in something. The fact that you didn't understand you couldn't afford it. So because you couldn't afford it, you're never going to derive the benefit from it, because you must. See, sometimes it takes a little bit of effort and pain to make something valuable. To get your bill, to get out of debt, you have to pay the price. Many of us have to order our credit report, find those people that we owe, contact them, see if you can make some kind of arrangement. I want to turn my credit around. It takes effort. And it's painful, but it takes discipline. And what the believer is missing now, the whole reason that we're allowing unrighteousness to flourish is because we want to live without discipline. When we don't even understand that the Bible says, go ye therefore, teach all nations, making disciples, disciplined followers. Followers that have discipline. Sometimes righteousness is just making up your mind to live a disciplined life. And some of us, in some areas of our life, we have gotten disciplined. You know, one of the places I'm disciplined is I'm rarely, if ever, late for work. And nobody has to set the alarm for me. Mama don't have to call me and say, you know, you got to be at work, get up. I know I got to get up. And I have disciplined myself, and I get up and go. But we have to have the same kind of discipline. If you're in some type of relationship that you know is wrong, you have to discipline yourself. And sometimes you have to take drastic steps. Block the number. Delete it. Erase, close. You know, some of us should have been closed the Facebook account. Wow. Oh, I'm in the Facebook. Lord have mercy. Next thing you know, you're gonna say, we're going to be talking Twitter. You know some of the people that you have befriended on your Facebook account you should never have befriended. Amen. Because the relationship was founded in unrighteousness. Hope ain't nobody getting mad at. I ain't got nobody's face. I ain't seen nobody's Facebook but my wife's. Right. But I don't know what's on your Facebook. This is the Holy Spirit talking. You know that there are things in your Facebook, your email, your text messages that you ought to take off because they belong in your past. There are things that you should have stripped yourselves of. But you're trying to hold on. See, one of the problems that makes it difficult for the believer to actually walk in righteousness is he is holding on to stuff from the past. Amen. You know, you strip yourself. The Bible, you know, it says, strip yourselves of your former nature and discard. We took our clothes off and we got them over in a pile in the corner. So that when the right opportunity presents itself, we can put that stuff back on. Well, one thing I learned as a backslider, and I can help backsliders, you on YouTube, if you pick this up, the backslider, is you'll never fit them clothes again. You'll put them on, but they won't look right on you. And people will look at you real funny like, that's how, you know, sometimes a dog look at me. They look at you because they're wondering that I saw you with some new clothes on. Now I see you and you back in them old dirty clothes you had on before, but they don't fit you right no more. You flooding. They too tight. You know, those that everybody, you know, so when you have really tasted of the goodness of the Lord and really got saved, then all of a sudden you backslide. People notice that you don't belong. It's something about you. So what you do is you overcompensate. Backsliders are, you know, it's better to have never known God and be a sinner than to know God and backslide, because when you backslide, you overcompensate in every area. I mean, I was backsliding, I cussed twice as much as I did before I got saved. I drank twice. I had to do everything. It was like I had to force myself back into, I had to put them clothes back on. And the Holy Spirit was trying to hinder me. He was speaking to me, don't put them back on. But I forced them on. You ever put some clothes on that's too small and you go to, you have to like, oh, you got to lay down. So you, now listen what it says next. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. That is the battlefield of righteousness. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations. That's the same as what we just read, that we have become corrupt through lusts and desires that spring from delusion. That's your imagination. That is you formulating in your mind a result that will never exist. You have convinced yourself that the result that you seek is there, but there is no result outside of righteousness that will be beneficial to you long term. I'm preaching real good this morning. Says, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Okay, before I go to the next verse, what has happened in some cases, we have put off the former man. We have, instead of discarding those clothes, we have set them in the dirty clothes pile. But we have not put on some new clothes. So many believers are walking around unclothed. One of my favorite childhood stories was the emperor's new clothes. You know, if you understood that story, the emperor, everybody was so fearful of the emperor. And the emperor desired new apparel, but nothing anybody presented to him was satisfactory to him. And you can imagine you go to the emperor and you bring him a fine suit and he gets disgusted with you and has you put to death for offending him with the wrong apparel. And what happened was a wise designer spoke to his imagination and told him that the apparel that he was putting on was so exquisite, that was so wonderful, that was everything that he desired. He never realized that he was naked as a jaybird because he had allowed his imagination. The clothes he thought he had on were only existed in his imagination. And sometimes the sin we walk in is because we've allowed our imagination to convince us that this lifestyle is beneficial to us. And until we put on some new clothes, we either got the old clothes over in a corner somewhere that are ready to be put back on, or we are walking around like the emperor naked with nothing on. Because we done put off, and that's the struggle with some believers. They stop doing everything. And they start to walk around and with a kind of an arrogant attitude as well. I don't smoke, I don't drink, I don't. And they go through and they, I don't. But if you don't put something on, sooner or later your I don'ts will turn back to I do's. Because there's nothing to keep you. So if you know, and that's the problem with some of the 12-step programs, is soon as you get away from your sponsor, soon as you get away from, you know, because you have not put nothing new on, you've only been abstaining. Abstaining. Mm-hmm. I'm giving you some personal revelation. I abstained from some things in my lifetime and then reverted back to them because I learned that I had never gotten delivered. Many of us are abstaining. Many of us are abstaining from a certain relationship. We the number's still programmed in our phone, but we don't call it. Or when it dials, we let it go to voicemail. Oh, I don't know who I'm talking to, but it's some stuff that we haven't completely let go. We haven't completely cut it off. We're abstaining. You know, we don't drink no more, but we still think about it. We don't hang with them no more. But we still think about it. True deliverance comes when you no longer think about it. It's almost like you can't even remember the experience. And that's true deliverance. That's the difference between abstaining and deliverance. It's like it never happened. It's no longer influential in your imagination, and God is capable of delivering your mind from your past. That's why the Bible says, forgetting those things which are behind, I press toward the mark of the high calling in Christ Jesus. That you put on the new man. Which after God, listen to what he wants you to put on. What are we dealing with? What exalts a nation? Righteousness. What's in the Bible 1,116 times? Righteousness. In order for us to get to that place after we have taken off the old man, after we have renewed our mind, the spirit of our mind, the next thing we need to do is put on some new stuff. and it says, put on new. Put on the new nature, the regenerate self, created in God's image, in true righteousness and holiness. Put on the new man. Put on something new. So this is the process for us believers, for the Dominion Now Word family. Amen. First step, get your mind right. Don't allow delusion, false. See, that's why it started in verse 10. Don't be carried about by every wind of doctrine. God's word is very simple. Without holiness, no man will see the Lord. Mm-hmm. Be ye holy, for I am holy. He wants you to have a simple, fulfilled life. So the first thing you have to do is be careful not to be tricked by wicked men that will speak into your life. And it's not just preachers. You got to be careful on the job. Folks will try to influence you into thinking the way that they think so that they can influence your behavior. People will take advantage of you on your job, at school, if they can speak into your mind and influence you, but it's always for their own benefit. Don't be a follower of anything but Christ. Amen. People will try to speak into you and try to get you to follow them. Everybody's trying to build up a little kingdom of their own and trying to influence you in it. And it's the craftiness, cunning craftiness. Well, let me read it the way I loved it, the way it was written in here, that it was cunning and cleverness of unscrupulous men in every shifting form of trickery, inventing errors to mislead. Some folk just want to be your friend because they know that you're the one that'll buy. Folk just want to invite you to the thing because they know you got the car. They're not interested in you. They don't want your friendship. They know we can't get there if we don't invite bro. Bro got a car. Yeah. So, sis got the connection. See, people, we got to get to the point where as believers, we understand that we have to stand, we have to be leaders, we have to have a clear mind, not easily influenced by others. Because many times people are influencing us for their own self-serving motives. Mm-hmm. That dude do not really like you. Like you think he do. That's right. He just wants what's between. Wow. Mm-hmm. And as long as he can influence you and get it for free, I wish I had more young ladies, young men here. We selling ourselves too short. I don't care for Beyonce. I don't care for Jay-Z. I don't like worldly music. I love gospel music. I love it. That's all I really want to hear. But I do know that she made a song that makes sense. If you really wanted it, you would have put a ring on it. Is that the song? You would have put a ring on it. You know, now I'm out at the club and you see me having fun, but now you got an attitude, but you didn't put a ring on it. I ain't going there. I'm just using, you know, like this is like the donkey. It makes sense because believers, young men ought not get involved with the female unless she's the one he wants to put a ring on. And young ladies, if you shouldn't be giving it up, See, in the church, there ought not be no baby daddies and no baby mamas. We ought to have enough in us, enough that we have not been influenced by unscrupulous and crafty men or women, that we understand that the true God's way is marriage. And ain't no sense in getting mad and not baptizing the baby, because the problem took forth. We didn't teach well enough before the fall. So, you know, we were watching something on the Word Network yesterday, and the question was, if a unmarried couple bring a child to you, would you bless the child? And they were arguing back and forth. I didn't even have to think about it. Of course I'm going to bless the child. Why? They mom and daddy didn't get together. Because I believe that my Savior said, suffer the little children to come unto me and hinder them not. They had nothing to do with the baby mama and baby daddy drama. So I'm not going to not bless the child because mom and daddy did not have enough discipline. I'm back to this discipleship. Enough discipline to live righteous. And the reason it is because we're easily influenced by crafty, you know, in the high school. There is no benefit in the world system to being a virgin. You are ostracized if somebody find out you a virgin. So you got all these children scrambling and struggling and influencing each other, so none of them were walking around with the stigma of being a virgin, when really being a virgin is a virtue. It's something that you ought to be proud of. Yes, I'm a virgin because I'm too valuable to just give myself away. This is asexual. Boy or girl, a boy ought to be just as strong. I'm too valuable. There's too much in me. I have too much potential to put my seed anywhere. And I'm too valuable to allow any seed in me. Because once again, I said earlier, the spiritual realm is greater than the natural realm. And whenever we come together with another person sexually, there's a spiritual bond that has been created. And many of us are walking around broke down, hurt on the inside because of bonds that we have made in our past, and it takes the delivering blood power of the cross to deliver us from it. But we have to teach our young people that you are too valuable. Young man, your seed is too valuable. Your seed might be the prophet that will change the world. You can't plant it anywhere. Young lady, your womb might be the one that will birth the changer, the second coming. You can't allow any seed in there. But that's discipline. And the reason that they're being allowed is because they're allowing, it is becoming, they're calling wrong right. They're calling in the schools, it's cooler to be promiscuous. There's no stigma to it anymore. In fact, the more promiscuous you are, the more likely you are to be popular and cool. When it ought to be, because if we understood this book, there are so many damaging things that can happen to you when we don't discipline ourselves not to hear the unclean voice, but to hear the voice of righteousness and make good decisions that will change our future. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Speak truth. Receive only truth. Your spirit knows when somebody's lying to you. Oh, baby, let me tell you, you know. No, You know, I before you opened your mouth, I saw where you was coming from. You know, it ain't just, I mean, it's the other way, too. She's
how you doing, Mr. Connor?
I'm doing fine. Put my stuff in the bag. I got to go. Be grinning up. You know, you have to speak that you have to understand and see. You have to be disciplined. That's what being a disciple is. The righteousness of a disciple is being disciplined follower of Jesus Christ. I'm going to close. Once again, I don't want to close without reminding of benefits of being righteous. Amen? There are many, many benefits. There, you know, the Bible says the Lord sees your righteousness and rewards your righteousness. The eye of the Lord is on the righteous. And I just want to share, well, I shared a few, but there is so many benefits to righteousness. The righteous shall see and fear and shall laugh at him. Your enemy will fall before you. The righteous, God has allowed the righteous to see the enemy fall before you. Those that have made your reproach, it says, then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifices of the righteous. Psalm 51:19. The sacrifices of righteousness with burnt offering and whole burnt offering shall they offer bullocks upon thine altar. There's so many, many. Cast thy burden on the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. Amen. I was young, now I'm old, but I have never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. The righteous shall rejoice when he seeth the vengeance. He shall wash his feet in the blood of the wicked. So that a man shall say, verily, there is a reward for the righteous. Verily, he is a God that judges in the earth. I could go on and on. There are so many benefits to being righteous. I want to ask a question. Where the saved folks at? Where is those that look, that people can look at and know, he saved, she saved, because they see righteousness on you. Not perfection. We all make mistakes, but there's a difference between making a mistake and being unrighteous. God is calling us back to righteousness. Give God a hand clap of praise. I'm going to close right there.